We're a newbie today. All right, good morning, Crossroads. How's everyone doing? All right, got some announcements for you guys. All right, so today, directly after service, we have a congressional meeting. Just updates, so stay tuned after service. It'll probably be before you go pick up your nursery kiddos. Okay, so we have a Vibe informational meeting. It'll be regular Vibe times. We know that we have a lot of students and parents that have questions that need answered, and we're here to do that. So regular times, Monday and Wednesday at 6:30. The email was wrong. It said 6. It's really 6:30. But yeah, that's that. And then we have Peace Meal signups this today. It's actually this next week. We need 2 people per day. It starts at 11:15, and you just go to the Livingston Center. So just please sign up on the welcome desk or contact me, and I'll get your info. We have our Trunk or Treat coming up October 23rd. I'm super excited about it. These are the little invitations out there, so grab a few, hand them out. We're really excited. This is like kind of like one of the first family fun things we've done in quite a while. So yeah, grab one. If you want to decorate your trunk, let me know so we can have you in our little contest and give you a number. And if you are going to participate in the Trunk or Treat, like decorating, bring your own candy to pass out. If you also want to donate, there's a purple box behind the welcome desk for candy donations. And then we have the local food pantry. They're needing non-perishable food items and toiletries. There's a tub out in the first part of the foyer for those donations as well. And then Project Bible Runners, this is the last week or so. So if you could just go ahead and get those Bibles in, that would be great. We're going to take those to another local church that sends them off so we can have as many Bibles as we possibly can. And then on our online giving platform, we mentioned it before that we're switching over to a new and better one. That cutoff date is going to be November 1st. So if you have automatic transactions coming out of your account like that, please be sure to do that, because effective November 1st, the old platform will be inactive, and so the new one. If you need help navigating that, let me know. It is on the app. There's like a little money sign it's giving, or you can go on the website, and there's that there too. And that's it. All right, so we're just going to say a little prayer before we go into worship. Lord, we just come to you this morning and just want to say thank you for bringing everybody here. We pray that we have open minds and open hearts, and we feel this wonderful music that we're about to listen to and participate in and worship in your name and your praise. Amen.
Let's all stand together and sing. Our rock, the only solid ground. Nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, are victorious. Unmasked in all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign. Every knee will bow. We bring our expectations. Our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus. Oh, we trust the name of Jesus. Victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
Our banner high.
We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are good, you are good. When there's nothing good in me, you are love on display for all to see. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sins. You are peace when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting. To your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign. running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus. Let's hear it. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus. Sing it one more time. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus. Amen. And I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where is found is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Where you are, where you are, Lord, is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense. helplessness. Oh God, how I need you. So teach my soul to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you, oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you.
Amen. Thanks for singing with us this morning. You guys sound great. We're so happy to have you all here today. Before you have a seat, why don't you find a few people around you, give them a high five, a howdy, fist bump, whatever you like. Go for it.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome all the kiddos. Hi, kiddos. Thanks for joining us this morning. Parents, thank you for your patience. We are working to improve some of our kids' spaces, which is some freshening up and some updates. And if you've ever done any sort of project, that takes longer than it's supposed to. So, welcome, children. Thank you so much. Just so you guys know, I say it all the time, but if you're new and your kiddos haven't been in here yet, they don't bother me. I promise. They don't bother me. Oh, I do need that piece of. Gotta be taken care of all the time. So they don't bother me. If you want to quiet them for your own sanity, that's for you. But please know they do not bother me. I've got three boys of my own.
They are loud and crazy, and it's awesome. So I love the energy that the kids bring this morning. So we are continuing in Matthew chapter 6, the Lord's Prayer section of the Sermon on the Mount. And really, I've been looking forward to this message. It's a very simple one, not super profound or different things. It's give us this day our daily bread. So we've been reciting the Lord's Prayer together, so we'll continue to do that for the next couple weeks. And then, so let's do that together right now. Here we go. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Maybe. Maybe. All right, Miss Liz, you're going to have to help me out. Or, oh, there you go. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. I'm being carried along this morning. Got to be taken care of. You're doing the reading. You guys are amazing. Thank you so much for carrying the service for me. So let's pray, and we'll jump into the message. God, this morning, we thank you so much that you are here, that you were here long before we came, and you'll be here long after we leave. God, we thank you for an opportunity to gather as family, to celebrate and rejoice together through worship. God, thank you so much for our worship team to lead us into your presence. God, it's just so wonderful to hear your people singing your praises. And so God, this morning, as we open up your word, give us ears that are ready to hear, hearts that are ready to be molded, and feet that are ready to be moved into action. And God, as always, anything that I say that's for me and my imagination, let it be forgotten before anyone leaves this room or logs off this video, but everything that's from you, let it stick forever. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. So, before I jump into the message, I also wanted to make sure I congratulated all of the St. Louis Cardinals fans in the audience for Mr. Pujols hitting 699 and 700 on the same day. That's big time. That's awesome. My Royals have been eliminated since June, so go Cards. Go Cubs. Go White Sox. Go everybody local. Royals will be back in 5 or 10 years. So, here in the Lord's Prayer, we jump into the second half. So the first half we've covered over the last few weeks, and now we go into the second half. And the first half is about honoring and reverencing God's name. As the hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, the things we've talked about over the last 2 weeks. This week, we look at the idea of God giving us something. And that phrase, give us, there, is really important. And I want to focus on that first. Each of the Greek verbs is in a specific verb tense. And the verb tense is very important to understanding the Greek. Now, I don't speak Greek, I don't really read Greek, but I can read people who understand Greek. So I have third-hand information. But the give there is in the aorist imperative. Okay, let me explain that. So the aorist imperative is a command for doing something in the future. Now let's push pause real quick. We are not commanding God to do anything. Okay? So when it says give us, we're not commanding God to do something. God is God. He does what he wants, when he wants, how he wants. And our job is to honor him in the meantime. So when we ask God, or we say give us this day, what we're saying is, God, command tomorrow's bread today. That's what it means. God, command tomorrow's blessings, tomorrow's sustenance, tomorrow's ability to be sustained, and do that today. And we do that because the goal is we pray this all the time. So we are walking today in what God gave us yesterday. So on Monday, God, give us this day our daily bread. What we're asking is, God, today, make Tuesday's bread ready. Because yesterday you made today's ready. And so we're always working in the future, so we're always thinking God is taking care of me today and tomorrow. It's this amazing faith that we have. It's this amazing trust that this prayer is asking us to have.
that we are saying, God, we honor you, we revere you, we want your kingdom to come, but please sustain us tomorrow in the same way you're sustaining us today. And thank you. And in doing so, we're actually thanking him for what he did yesterday, preparing for today. This is where the Lord's Prayer is so amazing, because it's like 8 sentences that just keep expanding and keep expanding and keep expanding. We are petitioning God for tomorrow's needs today. And that's why we're not anxious about today. That's why the Bible tells us to not be anxious about the things that we need. Because in our perspective, we're going to walk into the things that we need. We're going to go into tomorrow, and in our perspective, tomorrow's unsure. But from God's perspective, and when we pray this prayer, we can walk into tomorrow without anxiety, without fear, without concern. Because we've asked God and his sovereignty and his ability to command tomorrow's blessings already. And when I say blessings, I'm not talking about all the extra stuff. This is the sustaining. What sustains us, what keeps us alive, what keeps us going. Now, we have to be careful. We have to be careful because I've been around different people, and I've experienced different people who this is their lifestyle, is to pray, God, give us this day our daily bread, and then sit on the couch and wait for God to give it to them. That's not at all what it's talking about. It's talking about God providing ways for us to provide. Because we have to remember, work is pre-curse, pre-fall. So let's look at that, because we have to make sure we know that. Let's turn to the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 2. Because essentially, we can't use give us this day our daily bread as an excuse for laziness or irresponsibility. Genesis 2:15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to keep it. So the idea of work, the idea of taking care of something, the idea of providing was pre-fall. The curse, the fall, happens in Genesis chapter 3. And like I said last week, the fall then causes us to have to work hard. Work used to be easy. We didn't have to have sore backs and sweaty brows and calloused hands. Or if you're like me, bad backs and poor vision because I sit at a desk all day. Different kind of work. But the idea of working came before the fall. God wants us to work. It is good for us to work. And in so doing, we're able to work and step into tomorrow knowing that God will provide. And that's why we have to continue to thank God and ask God for our daily bread. And part of that is the employment that he's given us, or the resources he's given us, or the skills and talents that he's given us. We also have to notice that it says, give us, not give me. It's a very big difference. That Jesus teaches us to pray, give us this day our daily bread. And part of that is because we see in the book of Acts this idea of a community taking their daily blessings and ensuring that everyone has their daily needs. Because there are seasons in life where God can give you an abundance. That abundance is intended to ensure that those who have minimal are taken care of. Now, some of us are like, I don't have an abundance of money right now. What do you have an abundance of? Do you have abundance of time? Can you give that away? Can you share that? Whatever it is that God has given us that is in an abundance, we share it. And you see this again, like I said, in the book of Acts. So let's turn there. Acts chapter 2. It's in the New Testament.
after the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts chapter 2. Acts 2, verse 44. I've only got 44 up there, but we're going to read a little farther. Sorry. Acts 2, verse 44 says, "And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved." And so those who had, essentially, God had given two loaves of bread were ensuring that everyone had one loaf of bread. And they weren't doing it because it was a command to do. They were doing it because they had seen Jesus give everything, including his own life, for their sake. So in their minds, it was nothing. Because these are firsthand and secondhand witnesses of what had occurred. They saw this man walk the earth. They saw this man heal people, predict his own death and resurrection, and pull it off. And in so doing, they recognized that he gave everything. And so in their abundance, they were very willing to give to those, as it said, who had need. And in doing that, they gained the favor of the community. I think there's a connection. I think there's a correlation. That as we are generous, we gain favor. We gain, people have the right view of who we are. And it says again in Acts 4. Let's turn there real quick. Acts 4, verse 32. Acts chapter 4, verse 32. It says, "Now the full number of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one said that any of the things that belonged to him was his own, but they had everything in common." Now, I'm going to be real honest real quick. I don't want to live like that. Can we be honest for a second? That sounds not awesome. I like to have my things, and I like them in my place. And I like people to come over, but I also like them to leave. I knew somebody that understands. Okay? Especially like, you know, when you go to your restaurant and you come home and you got your leftovers, those are mine. I will write my name on them, and somehow, I never get to eat them. So while this sounds very holy and awesome, I don't want to. And here's the other part. So that's the funny part. Here's the not so awesome part. A lot of it's because of pride. I worked for those things. I earned those things. I went to college to get the degrees. I did the things. I got the thing. I did. And now I have my things, and they're my things. If you want your things, work harder. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Chapter 9, verse 8. 2 Corinthians 9, verse 8 says, "And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. Now, the ESV, that's a little confusing, so I want to read it to you in the New Living Translation. It says, "And God will generously provide all you need. Then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others." So, all the things that I think I have accomplished, all the things I think I have earned, are because God has given me or blessed me in doing it. That's what's really obnoxious, is nothing's actually mine. No, Pastor, I worked hard for that. Well, who gave you that work ethic? My dad. Who gave you your dad? See, we can just keep going back and back and back, and it always comes back to God gave you. And that's why Jesus wants to remind us every day when we pray, God, you give us. We're asking him to command, but we're also recognizing that's what he does. That's what he does. He is the God who provides. Not everything we want, but everything we need. And that's why over the last few weeks I've been asking you, I realized I forgot to remind you last week, forgive me. But through the Lord's Prayer, I'm asking you guys every day, once a day, to pray, God, meet me at the point of my greatest need. God, meet me at the point of my greatest need. Because I'll be honest, there's a lot of times in my life I don't even know what it is that I need most. I know what I think I need or what I want, but what is going to be most helpful for me in a certain situation, I don't always know that. But God does. And he is the source of all the blessings. And so we ask, you know what I need, God, meet me there. So the second part of this phrase, give us this day our daily bread. Our daily bread. That word bread there is that which is needed for the daily sustenance of life. That which is needed to essentially survive the day. And there's a lot of ways to look at this. There's a lot of ways in different cultures and in different areas, this message could take on a lot of different meanings. If we are in an upper middle class community, not many of us go and open our fridge and it's empty, or open the pantry and it's empty, and we're not sure how we're going to make it through the day for food. Now, some of you might have children, and so you go to your pantry and it's empty, but you have the resources to refill it. If we're in a third world country, this message is completely different. Give us this day our daily bread is literally, God, I need to eat today. I don't even have a clue how that's going to happen, but I need you to do it. But one thing is clear, regardless of what cultural context this message comes in, and it's found in John chapter 6. John chapter 6. It's before the book of Acts where we just were. Matthew, Mark, Luke, then John. Starting in verse 48. John in his gospel loved the number 7. And this is one of the things he recorded 7 times, the I am statements. And in John 6:48 it says, I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven so that you may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. That's beautiful. Okay? In our context. Can we just for a second not spiritualize that? Okay? Just for a second. you've been following this Messiah guy, this rabbi, you think, okay, he's doing some cool things, he's saying some weird things, but this guy's cool. And all of a sudden, he says, I am the manna from Exodus that your fathers ate. Now, what I want you to do is to eat my flesh. Can we not spiritualize it for a second and see how weird that is? People are always like, the Bible's boring. No, it's not. Sometimes we preach it boring. But these guys are following Jesus, and he goes, you'll live forever if you eat me. It's what? And the bread that I will give for that life of the world is my flesh. Now again, we go through time and it's like, oh, it's metaphorical, it's symbolic. Okay, they're going, no. That's weird. And then in 666, lots of people leave. And then one of the great lines of the scripture, Jesus looks at them and goes to his disciples and said, are you guys going? And I always think Peter looks around and he's like, no one's going to say it? Okay, I'll say it. We got nowhere else to go. You hold the words of life. Give us this day our daily bread. In you, Jesus, there is something that I need today. And I'm going to need that same thing tomorrow. And so, God, make ready today what I'm going to need tomorrow. Because the context of Matthew 6:11, when Jesus says, give us this day our daily bread, is physical, tangible, edible bread. The context through time is Jesus. Today, I need Jesus. I need the life that he gives. I need the words that he provides. And tomorrow, I guarantee I'm going to need it as much as I did today. And thank you, God, that you gave me today what I needed. And you prepared it beforehand. Because to the original audience, workers was an agrarian society, a farming society. And most of the people listening would have been people who earned a daily wage. You went to work in the morning, you finished in the evening, they paid you your wage. There was no weekly or biweekly salary. It was almost exclusively a day's wage. Now, most often, that day's wage would then be spent immediately with nothing much to carry over. So the idea was a day's work equals a daily provision, or a day's work purchased a day's food. So this idea of daily bread was not empty rhetoric to them. They would not have heard this idea of Jesus being their bread. They would have gone, awesome, this God is going to ensure that I make enough money to feed my family. That's what they would have heard. And they would have seen that the God that Jesus is speaking of is the God who provides every good thing. And so to them, it was still a really great message and really good news. Now when we step back and when they would pull back and when they would step back and see the whole picture of what Jesus is saying in this little phrase, they would have seen that not only does God care about my physical well-being, he cares intimately and deeply about my spiritual well-being. He cares about my eternal destiny. And that's why we're here this morning. We're here to ensure, with everything that we can, to present to you the good news of what God has done through Jesus Christ. So that you may know, and your children may know, and their children may know, that God is the God who provides every good thing, and the best thing he ever provided was Jesus. And in that, I can move from death to life, from slavery to freedom. And every time we pray, God, give us this day our daily bread, we're repeating the gospel. We're repeating what Jesus has done. So go back to the letters to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 4. 1 Corinthians 4. Because we have to make sure we have the right perspective. As we come to our close, we got to make sure we have the right perspective. 1 Corinthians 4, verse 7. It says, "For who sees anything different in you?" Love this. "What do you have that you did not receive? If then you received it, why do you boast as if you did not receive it?" So we can take this in so many places. All the things that we have, we own, we possess. We can act as though God did not give us that. That we did not receive that. That's what Paul is saying. Why do you, everything is a gift from God. Why do you act like it's not? Because the moment you do, it becomes pride. It becomes self-sufficiency. Which I think one of the most anti-Christ mentalities that I can have is self-sufficiency. I can do it on my own. I can manage on my own. Because when I do that, I'm my own God. I'm the only thing that I need. That's an antichrist spirit. What we need is the daily bread offered by God. And some of us can even get we can lack humility even in our own salvation. The farther we get removed from the moment of conversion, the moment of knowing who Jesus was, we can forget who we were the moment before Jesus found us. When we were dead in our trespasses. We can forget. And the farther we get removed from that, we can forget that God gave us that salvation. We received that. I played no part in my salvation. I like to think I did. You know, the pastor gave an altar call. I did raise my hand. Thank you very much. I stood up from my chair and I walked down to the front. Look, I took action. And what I received is a change in nature. I was able to give my sinful life for his life of righteousness. And I like to think I did something by going and praying. Like, why do I act as if I did not receive it? Because when I act like I did not receive it, what I'm doing is I'm creating so much distance between me and the people that God has said, go and make disciples of. Because I think I'm better. I lack humility to remember. I was saved on April 8, 2001. On April 7, 2001, I was them. No different. Probably worse. And then I received something, and my life changed. So we cannot act as if we have not received it. So I want to close with a verse from an old hymn. I won't sing it. I promise to never do that. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, daily bread. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. May that be the posture of our hearts. May that be the posture of our spirit when we come to God. We talked last week, we can come boldly, 2 weeks ago, we can come boldly as sons and daughters. But we also come with the posture of going, God, I recognize Everything I am, everything I have, and everything I need is found in you. Worship team, go ahead and come on up. I'm going to pray and then we'll close in a song. God, this morning we thank you so much for those words. Great is your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness towards us, and to our children, to this church. All we need, you provide. And whether we recognize it or not, you've always done that. Nothing has changed. And nothing will change. You're an unchangeable God. And so let us never grow tired or grow weary of thanking you for your faithfulness. Let us never grow tired or weary of asking for the daily bread that we need to be sustained every single moment of every single day. God, we speak death to our self-sufficiency and fall on you, lean on you, place our burden on you. And you are good and you are faithful, and we thank you for that. So God, as we sing this last song, let us do that from that posture, that mental attitude that you are great in your faithfulness. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Let's stand and worship.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And amen, amen, amen. Amen, amen, amen.
Sing, Lord bless you.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Generation. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations. generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you, and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children.
May his presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, he is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, and your going, in your weeping, and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you. May his presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, he is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, and your going, in your weeping, and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you. He is for you, 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 he is for you. Amen, amen, amen,
children, and the children, and the children.
May his presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, he is with you,
in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, and your going,
in the weeping, and rejoicing. He is for you, for you.
We thank you that your daily bread is not just for us. It's for everyone around us. It's for those who need it. It's for those close. It's for our family. It's for our children and our children's children. God, thank you so much for that blessing. Thank you that we can come to you knowing that you are the God who provides, that you are faithful, and you always will be. In every good situation, in every hard situation, you are faithful. We love you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You guys can go ahead and be seated real quick. All right, if you're watching the live stream, we're going to see you guys later. We're going to, if we can turn off the live stream real quick, we're going to, elders and I will like to give an update on what's going on.